Well, hello, everybody. And he says hello too, good old Father Solanas. There are certain individuals that are ahead of the game. And so what we want to do today in this installment of Interview with the Exorcist is to try to keep you at least abreast of what kind of ideas might be crossing your mind after listening to these episodes and this episodic journey into Dr. Douglas Gabriel from Southwest Detroit. I'm John Barnwell, I'm up here and I'm north of Detroit and the beautiful city of Detroit, the Paris of the Midwest, and a very, very magical city that has shown over the years to be a sanctuary of a great deal of esoteric content that went out of the flowers, shall we say, that the wind blew across the flowers and the pollen went all over the place. And so now we're trying to see if any of the seeds that went out with the pollen have found fertile ground. And so, without further ado, hi, Douglas.
Hi, John. That's exactly right. I see a dandelion, you know, and all those seed pods flying off, because our best friends are like in the four corners of the world. You know, they're not here anymore, but it's okay. We're still here and we're still holding the sacred ground. And today, last week I talked about some very deep things. And then today I text John and said, this is what I'm going to try to talk about today. And he was just making a joke about, oh, that's all, you know, no, we're going to talk about the deepest stuff. Matter of fact, what do you call it? High weirdness and
high strangeness,
and paradoxical logic, and it is paradoxical, because what I'm going to tell you today is like last week. I haven't even told John a lot of these things, because why? It just sounds like I'm making it up. It sounds like I'm a lunatic. But let me tell you, when I was young and with Father Williams, those of you who know, I was with a priest for 4 years, training as his protege, and he was an incredible being. Matter of fact, I was just thinking as you started the introduction, you know, Father William was like a saint. Everybody wanted his attention, and he was my teacher, and he was in a wheelchair, and I pushed him around in a hospital, but he wasn't limited to the hospital. There were three hospitals in town. He went to all of them, especially to the psychological wards, to help people who had all kinds of strange disorders, because he was an exorcist. And this was a Catholic hospital we're in, and so we got, it was a huge hospital, too. We got so many people in the psych ward. So I was thinking this morning, how many crazy people have I worked on with Father William? Hundreds. Hundreds. So last week when I talked about experiencing the Damascus event, where both Tyler and I have had that event, and that is what led us to write the trilogy, the Gospel of Sophia, and all of our other work is really all stems from unpacking the experience of meeting Christ in the etheric, the second coming of Christ. So you don't have to wait for rapture. And it is true that mankind as a whole will go through the apocalypse. But right now, every single person goes through the apocalypse when they die. And you're going to meet a being each night when you sleep. And that being is going to, for the Christians, sometimes they consider to be Saint Michael holding a sword and scales, because he judges you before you go to sleep and says, no, you can't bring that stuff here. You have to resolve it. You have to have a clear conscience. And then when you die and you go to heaven, you know, the Catholics believe you see St. Peter at the gate, at the pearly gates. And he then somehow knows what's written in the Book of Life, whether you're going to be let in or not. Well, we could ask John. John, I want you to at some point just go ahead and wax poetic about what the Steiner says about the Egyptians. When they would go to sleep at night, they'd meet the Sphinx, and he'd ask them the riddle, and they really didn't have much of an eye development, of an ego, a personality, an ego that they had developed. And so therefore they're able to go to sleep very easily. But in today's world, we're such gigantically egotistic, hyper egotistic people that we have so much to carry across the threshold that you're not allowed to go across because you're filled with all the garbage that you'd like to bring. And so you have no light to bring into the spiritual world. Therefore you don't see anything and you don't wake up at night and you can't bring dreams into the day. And so then, but when you died in Egypt, you had to see Anubis and he would weigh your soul against an ostrich feather. And if you were found lacking, then, that's not so good. John can tell you about all those horrors. But we have these beings that meet us at the threshold. And I'd have to say, as I was talking last week about seeing Christ in the etheric through your own angelic realm, which is the realm of the astral light, and you're seeing the angel body of Christ, the archangelic body, the time spirit body or archai body. And then if you actually can get to the point of seeing Christ, you're seeing Christ emanate as an Elohim. And you can't really look at that. You don't have, unless you had fantastically developed initiatory, supersensible organs, there's no way you're going to be able to continue to perceive those being, those outer layers of Christ's manifestation. But I was trained to deal with that every single day. Every day we went around the hospital. I was pushing him in a wheelchair, and he would handle the people who would ask that to see a priest, doing, of course, last rites, that the hospital was a Catholic hospital. They'd call you in to do last rites, even if you didn't ask for it sometimes. And so we were constantly doing last rites for people who were dying and going across the threshold. People who were in fantastic pain that no medicine could stop, no painkiller could stop. Or in the psych ward, we would see the following. This was during the Jesus Restoration Movement, matter of fact, the Jesus Revolution time that I was working with him. And as I pointed out before, the nuns, and so everybody in the hospital came to him, Father William. He was the priest. He was the resident priest. He lived in the hospital and he was in a wheelchair. And so the nuns run the place and they answer to him. And so he was not only an expert for that hospital, but he was an expert for, because he had had a lot of experience running large organizations, the largest house of formation called Conception Abbey, as well as another one out in Iowa, I believe, and so on and so forth. So he was really, really, really well-known, sought-after person. And so we would not only go to the psych ward there at that hospital, we'd go to the psych ward across town, we'd go to the other psych ward and the other hospital, and then we'd go out to the federal prison where my dad worked. And that was the medical institute, the Federal Prison Medical Institute. In other words, where the criminally insane were sent, right? Yeah. And so we'd go out there. So I drove him after I got my license. I was his driver. I drove him to all the, but before that, we had a bus. They'd drive us anywhere he needed to go. So every single day, I would encounter people who were across the threshold and couldn't come back, or had had experiences with the threshold and were so terrified by their lower nature, called the doppelganger or your double. And someday we'll have to make clear distinction between why people get so confused about the word doppelganger and double. But let's just say the unredeemed parts of your thinking, feeling, and willing. When you get to the threshold between the physical and the spiritual world, it's going to pull them apart and show them to you. And it's not a pretty picture. Even for a saint, if saint would be even more harsh on themselves about their inadequacies of doing the will of the divine, so their willpower would still come up as a monster. So what are you going to do about with that monster? Well, these monsters scare the snot out of some people, and they go into a psychotic embolism and then display schizophrenia of delusion, belittlement, what's called the Messiah complex, the God complex. We saw all of them. But especially what we would see is the hippies who took too much acid and saw the white light. John's laughing because how many times have you known a hippie who came and said, I saw the white light, Jesus Christ talked to me. And then later they may say, and I am Jesus Christ, or I am God. And you'd go, yes, you are. You have the message of the Bible. Good work.
Thankfully, we only had a few of them that self-identified, that announced themselves.
Yes.
Back in the day. It was always interesting because this one guy comes in and he's starting, and he like read like one, maybe two Steiner books, and he goes, "You know, I'm him." Go ahead.
That he's Steiner or that he's Christ?
He's Christ. He yeah. Just want to let you know that, well, he's talking about me. You know?
Okay. Now, there's a variety of ways to look at this. For me, because I'm really I have some kind of temporal singularity in my brain or my heart or something, so I don't get time. But so I'm gonna be bouncing back and forth here to talk about this today, because when I saw these things, I could see them. I could experience them. I knew what those people were. I knew what they had experienced. I had already experienced it myself. But I didn't get identified with thinking that I was that angel, archangel, archai, or Elohim, the being of Christ, that I encountered. But look, over a great period of time, we all better become Christened, or you've fallen behind evolution. You have three higher spiritual selves. The first one is to develop basically your higher ego. The second one is basically to have that higher ego merge with the group soul of all Christian beings that have come out of Earth evolution and Jupiter evolution. Well, I should be careful. I use these terms, but anyway, that have arisen out of evolution. So we all become part of a group soul that is Christed. But then we go beyond that. Then you become individualized and take the responsibility for being a Christ, Christened being. So for a person to have experienced a separation of their astral body from their etheric body, their desire body from their life body, is normal when you take too much LSD. Yeah, well, why'd you take 10 or 20 hits of LSD? In those days, it was very real stuff, you know, and it could kill you. It wouldn't quite kill you, but it'd make you think you were dying. So we at the coffee house, at the Jesus Restoration coffee house we had called New Wine, they would come in every weekend. Every weekend, and because I was a performer and sang and played there and was one of the writer for the newspaper and this, and I was totally into the Jesus Restoration movement. At the same time, I was being trained by a Catholic priest who was totally hip and was into the spirit. And so in these psych wards, I would meet people who had these experiences again and again and again. And so when I finally realized, because he never really point blank told me, that we were basically doing kind of a shortened form of exorcisms on these people to see if we could help, and or assessing them to see just how crazy they were, or whether it was, you know, how it arose. Because if you can find out how it arose that they believe that they're St. Paul or Jesus or Mary Magdalene or Mary, the mother of, or Jesus Christ or God, talk to them. And if you can get them to talk about how they got there, you can find the trauma that might have separated those bodies, and then you can help them get back together. And in some cases, we saw miraculous healings. In other cases, we saw no healing at all. So these are cases. Rudolf Steiner said that after 1930, the second greatest event of our time, which you'll find, by the way, in the two URLs in the show notes below, you'll find two articles that we did, one on the etheric Christ and one on the guardian of the threshold. They're both incredibly instructive because I use Rudolf Steiner's words and let him speak for himself, telling you about these things, because he's one of the few people who have spoken about these things. And for me, I had experienced these things and I was experiencing them. And here I am, I'm 14 years old. And every single day after school, I'd say mass with this priest, and was given extraordinary ordination after like 6 months of working with him, and you know, went through priest training with him. And every single day I saw possible miracles, potential miracles, for sure, paranormal happening, super, and through the fact that somehow I was born with these supersensible organs, I was able to look at this and see it and see what was happening, and then tell my teacher, Father William, well, this is what I see. And that, you know, what about that? Why does that look that way? And so on and so forth. So he could read auras, but, you know, reading auras and reading somebody's chakras and the colors from their chakra petals is stage one. That's like for beginners. You got to get to the etheric body and then down into the physical body. And then you might find out the causal root of a problem. Because if you don't know the causal root of a problem, you don't know whether it can be healed or not. So you might just be wasting your time, just like that new movie about Gabriel Amroth. Yeah, he did, 70,000 exorcisms and didn't heal anybody? So what good is that? I'd rather have Father William tell me the secret prayer he'd whisper into people's ear that really wasn't a prayer. It was an intention that he had created some of these things that, he could just tell people, I want the peace of Christ to come into you now. And they could be screaming with pain and they'd stop. So we could get to some of these people and say, why do you believe you're Jesus Christ? Well, because I took too much acid and I had the experience that I thought I was dying. And then an angel came to comfort me. And then a bigger being came. And the angel came as light and it knocked me to the ground. And then the bigger being came and it was filled with sound that deafened me. I thought I'd never be able to hear again. And then it came with words that spoke to me. And the words were, go to new wine and tell them you've met Jesus Christ. This is the only message the person would get. And they, where's new wine? So they'd find this little coffee shop and they'd come to us and we'd go, yeah, come on in. We got a group of you in the back. Come on in. So we dealt with this all the time. Now, why is that real? Why is that not fake? If it started happening in the 1930s as the second coming of Christ and the etheric, through your astral body. But if your astral body's messed up on LSD, what do you think is going to happen? If you were close to dying, you might have turned to your own religious symbolism, but most of these people weren't religious. Or you might be religious and think that you turned into St. John the Divine or St. Paul, or that you were, Simon, or you were the person who helped carry the cross of Christ. Or, like the church told you to do, you started living into the Via Della Rosa, the path of suffering of Christ, the way, the truth, and the life. And so the way, many people interpreted as the stations of the cross. In other words, personally, with all your might, all your astral body, your etheric body, your physical body, with your ego, with all your intention, with your heart of hearts, you wish to relive the life of Christ. Well, what happens to those people? Some of them get stigmata. Some of them become aenetic. They stop eating and don't have to eat. There are many, many cases of this where they just drink water. There's one lady in Russia, she'd eat an apple a year just to entertain people that she was eating something and wasn't going to die. Or you have people who have stigmata. Now, here's what I want to tell you. You don't want stigmata, except for a very short time. I know it happened to me, but mine was different than normal. But as you, it's always an aberration for me. But to bleed from the body is not a big deal, especially if you're trying to emulate the life of Christ. But that's a stage. Don't get caught in that stage. And don't believe some of the stories that, I don't mean to belittle some of the stigmatas who the Catholic Church has endorsed or not endorsed, but let's just say the two largest ones are fake, where a lady had stigmata and then she wrote down her visions of Christ, and they aren't really correct. So it doesn't mean anything that you have stigmata, except that you're going through the proper stages of the Via Della Rosa, the suffering of Christ. Well, we got people like that in the psych ward. When the doctors couldn't handle it, and they thought the person was crazy and they wanted to permanently, lock them up because they didn't know what to do with them. In those days, they actually had psychological hospitals or sanitariums. They'd send people. As a matter of fact, right here in Ypsilanti, they had the case of the three Jesuses or the three Christs. So they put three of them together to see if they'd wear each other out. And in the end, no, they ended up respecting each other and saying, yes, God, yes, Jesus, and treating each other like they were who they said they were, and they turned out just to be nice people. So what is that? That is called the realm of spiritual economy. Christ perfected the physical realm when he incarnated, was crucified, went through the 3 days, resurrected, and ascended to heaven, and now has gone to the throne and come back. And now he's in the etheric, okay? So that is the physical of that. Now Christ is in the etheric. So the second coming of Christ is in the etheric realm, the second greatest mystery and the second greatest event of all of human evolution is happening right now. So if you feel bummed you didn't get to meet Jesus when he incarnated in a physical body during an incarnation at the same time, some people go through that. Some people go through that so intensely that they believe that they were there. You know how many people I've met who have told me that they were there under the cross? You know how many Mary Magdalenes I've met? I can't tell you. Rudolf Steiner once said, well, you probably remember the quote better than I, John. He said, yes, well, that notwithstanding, having met X number of women who claim to be Mary Magdalene, that is not really the way that karma works. He's, you know, given this explanation. No, it isn't. But I have met people who believe that they really are those beings. We have one right now in the Anthroposophic Society. I won't say her name. We have another stigmatist in the Anthroposophic Society who is also anedic. She doesn't eat, supposedly. But is that really the path of spiritual development? No, it's the gradual path. Because if you go to the threshold and you go across too quickly and you see these perfected vehicles in the etheric, you might become associated and obsessed with one of them and think that you are that. Well, the good news is, and then I'll stop my tirade here, the good news is you are all that and you can channel all of that. Just don't think it's going to be 24/7. You might get it for one nanosecond in your whole life that you get a glimpse of the perfected vehicle of some saint and you take it into yourself and it transforms you as an inspiration through intuition, through love. But it does not mean that you should become identified with it. But how many people are so, whether they acknowledge it or not, obsessed with their own Messiah complex? This is the reason why. So there is a second coming. It's not in a physical body. It's in the etheric. Everyone can access it, and everyone can access the perfected vehicles of Christ if you have the moral development for that. But most people don't. And so my training as a youth in these kind of things, as an exorcist, but I didn't know in many cases that that's what I was actually doing. We were just working at the threshold with basically 1 foot across the threshold, trying to help people who were stuck at the threshold, freaking out on one side because of fear or freaking out on the other side because of luciferic delusion that they are what it is that they see in the spiritual world.
Well, to try and unpack something that could happen in the blink of an eye is a journey that many, many people have taken. And so don't think you're special if you start having some kind of super sensible experience. And as far as the stories that Douglas is sharing, that is, he's very reticent about sharing, you should feel kind of humbled to be able to look at somebody else's suffering, because this was not fun. Don't think that he did this for entertainment. And in fact, that he represented, he was the Cullum, okay? He was the dove. He was the instrument of purity at that stage. Of course, he lost that.
Thank you, John. Eventually. Thank you for pointing that out.
Eventually, you know, and it's hard to maintain that kind of a state of purity to be able to serve as the kind of a rudder or a presence of purity that is very effective against the shadowy elements that can assault people's consciousness. If you get into understanding this, it ultimately will resolve itself into the concept of dweller on the threshold or the guardian on the threshold, variously so-called, since the wonderful story by Edward Bulwer Lytton, Zanoni. And in Zanoni, we have the experience of the dweller on the threshold. And it's also made reference to after that in many theosophical articles. You can go Google dweller on the threshold or guardian on the threshold, and you're going to find just there's a whole subcategory of literature that you could peruse and gain certain insights. But one of the best is C.G. Harrison. And he says, no one who is past the dweller on the threshold could ever be tempted to reveal the secret of the threshold. For only a madman would saw off the branch on which he sits. It is the knowledge that pertains to the region beyond, about which there are differences of opinion as to how much is prudent to reveal. Much of this knowledge, it would be a plain duty to communicate to the world, if we were sure it would not be misused. Certain facts connected with human generation would be useful for everyone to know. Many of the evils which spring from ignorance of the causes of disease might be easily averted, and the diseases themselves removed without recourse to drugs. Much time and labor might be saved if the ratio of consonant etheric vibrations were known, and our skillful mechanicians thus in a position to avail themselves of, quote, nature's finer forces, end quote. But the trouble is that none of these things could be revealed by themselves. The mystery of birth and death is a key to the portals of an unseen world inhabited by man's most deadly foes, deadly on account of the sympathy which exists between his lower and their higher nature, constituting a fatal bond of attraction, wholly evil in its effects on humanity. In the same way, the knowledge of how to cure disease cannot be separated from the knowledge of how to produce it. And it is a very grave question whether, on the whole, the diffusion of this knowledge would be a blessing or a curse on society as it is at present constituted. I mean, I could go on, but in other words, the tremendous responsibility attached to the understanding of the dweller on the threshold, it's that it's really not a toy that you mess around with. But find Transcendental Universe by C.G. Harrison on the Internet Archive. The whole book is there, or you can buy the book. There's a nice edition that was made with Christopher Bamford's introduction, and it's a wonderful journey into Rosicrucian esoteric thinking from an individual who's unattached to any organization and not under oath to anybody not to say anything. He just has his own measure of balance regarding these things. He tells the story of how he shared with a young individual some of the details regarding that making the transition past the dweller on the threshold, and that he wished he hadn't done it because it produced an unbalanced result. So these things are very, very serious things to when you look at them. They're not like these parlor games that some people play.
It just amazes me the way you pull out the quotes that go along with the other parts of what I was planning to talk about that I didn't tell you. It's just,
well, isn't that what you asked me to do? I mean,
yeah, that's your
people
job.
He might send me one sentence. This is the next show, there's like three concepts in the sentence.
I have to move with the spirit. So I'm going to tell a story. Now, I couldn't figure out how in the world I could possibly weave this story into what I previously just said in my long diatribe. Well, you know this person, so I'm not going to say, and you know why I'm not going to say who this person is, but I'm going to tell you a little story to underscore what John just said. These are deadly serious things, and if you try to guide someone in the wrong way and it turns out bad, then they end up in the psych ward. So, yes, when you go to meet the dweller on the threshold, if you're doing it through initiation and you're going to meet the lesser guardian through initiation, meditation, conscious attempt to cross the threshold, you're going to meet a scary being. For the Greeks, it was like the three-headed dog, Cerberus. And then you had to have the coin in your mouth. You couldn't get across the river. And then you were done in. Where'd you go? You don't exist anymore. But if you had the coin in your mouth, then Charon would ferry you across the River Styx. Otherwise, you could get into the realm of waiting, which is the underworld of the Greeks. So whoever we want to look at in history, when you meet the threshold, in the past, it was a different experience than it is now. Now it's terrifying because it's going to show you self-knowledge. It's going to show you all of your inadequacies. And so when you start to do any of this work, you better realize that it will make you look at life and death. And in some of these cases, these were people who had tried to commit suicide, of course, as well as, you know, we helped ferry across many a person who died as we were standing there in the hospital next to them. And we were called, you know, for the last rites, but even more than that, the last moment. And so I got to see what happened when people passed away. And if they were good people, they passed out through the head. And if they were bad people, they passed out through the feet. And you could see this. And so I followed people. I followed my brothers when they died. I followed them because Rudolf Steiner tells us what you go through when you go across the threshold. Now, I want to go back to John's point. This is no parlor game. Okay, at one point, I admit, I was a psychic for hire. And so the word went out and I was called by just every crazy situation. So I get called by this one situation, and it's with a person who is one of the richest families in Detroit. And I'm not told what it's about. I'm just saying, we'll pay the best money for the best psychic. So I go there and I pull into the driveway and four armed guards come running out to the car. And there's four guns pointed at my head and they got they're cocked and they're going to shoot me. And it's like, wow, this is the beginning. What's going to happen when I go in here? So the person who's the owner of the house, you'll know this story because you know it when it happened. You knew it when it happened, but I'm not going to say who the person is. She opens the window and screams at them. He's here to see me, you fools. Starts screaming at these four guards, right? And says, come on in, come on in. Set him down in the such and such room, and I'll be down in a minute. What a woman. Anyway, so I'm sitting in the room, and her secretary comes in because I asked for a pencil because I thought I was going to do readings. So I thought I'd have to write down their birthdays, and I usually write down their a bunch of stuff and da da da. So I asked for a pencil. But as she's walking back into the room, I see her involved in a crime that happened in that room. I didn't want to see it. I didn't come there to see it because I was in an open space. I was getting ready to do some work with somebody, right? Some big wig, you know, I didn't never met this person before. I see this girl let in these guys in these brown one-piece suits to work on the house, some technical part of the house. But as the guys are walking by me, right in front of me, right where I'm staring, there's this beautiful table, and they pick up, you know what I'm going to say? They pick up these little tiny things that are, some of them worth over $1 million a piece. Do you know this story, John? You don't know it. Yeah, so these guys stole like $20 million worth of a collection from one of the richest families in Detroit that had gone way back in their family. And for some foolish reason, these people set it there where you could actually pick them up. And I see this, and I see them come in and they steal it and then they go out. And I'm going, whoa, that's why she wants me here. Or maybe this happened in the past. Now, what am I looking at there? What did I see? I saw an imprint on what's called the Akashic or Akasha. Steiner calls it many names. Akasha Chronicle, Akashic Chronicle, Akashic Records, the Skein of Time. And he says that it's not just written into like the visual impression of what happened. It's written into the intent of the people. So if you can go past the astral, past the etheric, and get into the physical, and you can be still awake, you may see and witness, it's not really seeing, you are in the situation. You are not separate. You are in the situation as an empath. You are feeling what those people are feeling. You're seeing their thoughts, thoughts they may not have even revealed to the world. And Steiner describes this in great detail.
You can even have exchanges with these people.
Okay? Exactly.
Even though they... they're probably like reincarnated off somewhere else, totally unaware of it, but you can interact with that which remains from them in the Akashic Record. And that, some of these things are kind of difficult to get a handle on. But I want to give you just a little bit here that'll help, I think, in initiation and its results. Chapter 6, the first guardian of the threshold, that's Collected Works, Volume 10, which is now known as Knowledge of Higher Worlds. But here it says, among the important experiences that accompany an ascent into the higher world is that of meeting with the guardian of the threshold. In reality, there is not only one such guardian, but two. One is known as the lesser and the other as the greater. The student meets with the former when, in the manner described in the last chapter, he begins to loosen the connection between the volitions, the will, the thoughts and feelings so far as they concern the etheric and astral bodies. The meeting with the greater guardian occurs when this loosening of the links further extends to the physical body, that is to say, the brain. The lesser guardian is an independent being. It did not exist before the individual had arrived at this particular point in his evolution. This is a second warning received at the threshold from its guardian. No one can attain to this vision unprepared, but the higher training, which generally makes it possible for a person to pass on the threshold, puts him simultaneously in a position to find at the right moment the necessary power.
I think that quote may be in the article below this podcast, and that is the best place to go, Knowledge of Higher Worlds, to get the description of the lesser and greater guardian. If you want to be initiated, you're going to have to meet the lesser guardian, and when you die, you're going to meet the greater guardian.
Now, this is the thing that I saw before I experienced enlightenment at 19 years of age. Now, I had heard the name Rudolf Steiner, but I hadn't even really engaged myself in that. But yet, I saw this, and when I saw this, I knew that I was facing something that was inevitable, that I knew was going to take place before I was born. And on, I mean, it's all woven into my own personal destiny for whatever reason. I didn't know at the time. All I knew was it was absolutely familiar, and that the whole world, the universe, split into two pieces. And on one side was more like the ability to engage with the material world. On my left and on my right, there was this area of haziness and darkness that I couldn't gaze into unless I was able to bring my own light with me, like the hermit and the tarot card. You know, you need a light to light your way. And that was the dilemma in ancient Egypt that Douglas was referring to, because if you go back in Rudolf Steiner's work to the first post-Atlantean period, 2,160 years, the old Indian period, in that ancient time, and this is like way before these things were written down, you had the seven rishis and the Manu and that whole momentous event. But people at that time had a more real relationship to the spiritual world than they did to the material world. It wasn't until the next period that they began to really engage with the material world and see a profound value in it in the age of Zarathustra. Although Zarathustra did incarnate in that old Indian period, it's when he began his series of seven incarnations in the age of Gemini that he brought about the Zendavesta and the whole idea of the relationship to Zervan or time. And so you have this unfolding, but also at that time, you have the arising of a form of demonology, that there was consequences that resulted from engaging with the world. so that when we get to the next period, the age of Taurus and the age of ancient Egypt and Babylonia and Mesopotamia, the spiritual world was gradually receding so that one did not have sufficient light to illuminate that state. And that's what initiation was about, was to be able to get to, what do they call it? They call it enlightenment. Well, why? What's up with that? You know, it's like, well, because if you're not enlightened, if there's not this enlightenment, if there's not this help from Osiris coming from the sphere of the moon at the behest of Isis, that if you can't assimilate that mystery, you won't be able to perceive. And that's the gist of, and you can go and you can talk to Egyptologists, and of course, they don't know what I just told you. See, because it's really only people that have been there that can talk about these things in a particular way.
And there's a battle going on, make no mistake about it. And there's a battle for your soul, and every single thing you think, feel, and will, if it doesn't go into truth, beauty, and goodness, then it goes to feed the demonic realms, what's called the eighth sphere. So, you know, that's what the threshold teaches you. So if you want to go to the threshold, good luck. It's going to kick you back because you're going to be looking in a mirror and you're going to be seeing three nasty demons. And who are they? You. So if you don't embrace them and kiss them and hug them and love them and work out why it is you do such bad things, then you're going to keep on doing them. So anyway, I'm in this lady's house. I see that her personal secretary, who has just let me into the house, let me into the room, is the person who was paid a great deal of money to let these workers into the house who were coming in to steal these objects. About that time, the lady of the house comes down, the one who threw open the window and yelled at them, leave him alone, let him in. So she comes down, she starts telling me this story. And pretty soon as I'm reading her, because she wants me to be their reader, so I know she wanted me to read her, as I'm reading her, I'm realizing what's going on. She's calling over her two best friends and she wants to do a Ouija board with me as a psychic to enhance their Ouija board sessions, John. And one of them is her best friend, and her husband is this lady's ex-husband's financial advisor. So she's telling me about this person, and all of a sudden I'm going, oh, that's the person who stole the objects. He's the person in a wheelchair who sent in the guys to steal these, I'm going to say what it is, even though you probably can look it up online. Oh, well, stuff like, there's snuff boxes from like the Tsar of Russia and the King of England. And like, you know, these, they're so dadgum expensive. It's like what a rich person does with their money when they have infinite money. So they were stolen, right? So she's really calling me in because her dead husband talks to her through the Ouija board and her best friend's dead husband talks to her through the Ouija board. And they're getting conflicting information to try to figure out who stole them to try to get them back. And so they call me in. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm like, oh, Lord, what have I gotten myself into? How in the world can I be of help and yet let them know that using a Ouija board is one of the worst things they could possibly do to try to reach the dead? They're not ever going to reach the dead that way. They're going to reach all other kind of weird elemental beings and astral shells and you name it. But no, they're not going to get what they want. So we sit down at the Ouija board. After the ladies come in, oh, I give them a card reading, right? Oh, they're so happy. You know, no one's ever, oh, I feel so naked in front of you. You just read my soul. I went, yeah, you are naked. Now, let's, you know, I should say, and don't do Ouija boards. But anyway, so then we go into this room. And in one end of the room is a gigantic fireplace. And then the other end of the room is a full-on real stuffed gorilla. Gigantic silverback gorilla. That's the kind of people I'm dealing with. So we sit down at the table and they, before I even put my hands on that device, it starts moving. The three ladies put their hands on it and I reluctantly get ready to put my hands on it. And it starts moving. And so I stop. I said, oh, you guys are doing a good job. I'm thinking I'm going to back out of this one. And it says, welcome, Lawrence. It's so good to see you again. And that's every time a Ouija board talks to me, it calls me Lawrence. No matter where I am in my life, what period, it does not matter. They call me Lawrence. A lot of weird spirits call me Lawrence. I don't know what that's about. Anyway, it says, welcome, Lawrence, blah, 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 blah. And then she says, well, put your hands on it. It's never gone this fast before. It's never worked so well. You must really be do-da-da-da-da. So I put my hand on it, and then it starts spelling out this thing, this crime, okay? It starts saying things about the crime, and then I take my hands off of it. And when I take my hands off of it, the, what's that thing called that moves around on the Ouija board? There's a name for it. It
planchette.
The planchette. I knew you knew. That's the reason it was worth waiting for. The planchette zooms off the board, flies across the room, hits the fireplace, and breaks into a bunch of pieces. The three ladies go nuts. That's the greatest sign from the spirit they've ever had.
Poltergeist.
It was a poltergeist. But why was there a poltergeist? Because her dead husband, the rich lady's dead husband, is now interacting with the dead financial director, and they're knowing the truth, because now after you die, you experience what you did to the other. So now they both know the truth, and their wives are in the room and they don't know the truth. And I'm conflicted in the room because I know the truth, but I can't really help the situation, because if I tell her, then literally both her best friends were involved in this. Their husbands were involved in this. This was, but then why wouldn't they plan to steal, you know, millions of dollars worth of snuff boxes and then sell them someplace? So what I did do is I said, okay, I'm going to go home and I'm going to go into trance and I'm going to see if I can find where they went. And I did. But I'm a conscious trance person. I don't go in a trance. So I'm writing it down. And so I got an address.
Theta?
It's a theta state. And you go, and I was writing down the address and where in London, the section of London it was. And they went there and they found some of them. This was a place where they had sold them, the
auction house.
Well, these criminal auction house. fence. They found the fence. Because I told them the address. I was one number off, but they were able to find it. It was one of the last numbers. And so they just looked at it because I described the place. Because I could see it and I could see the address. It was a little blurry. So I got one of the numbers running. So they went there. They found some of them. I couldn't tell them the rest. And this is the point of the story. I couldn't tell them that I knew where the most expensive ones were, because the guy in the wheelchair had buried them right outside the door, of his den. He put them in a box and buried them in the ground. And as far as I know, they're still there today. But I couldn't tell them that, because if I did, that was their best friend. If I told you how good a friend this woman was to her, you wouldn't believe it. Because they used to work together, and they came into richness together because of who they met. And anyway, never mind. You know who I'm talking about now. And that it was all over the newspaper. Matter of fact, if you did the right query right now, it'd come right up and you'd go, oh, and a psychic found where they were blown, because it hit the news. And so, well, did I do any good or did I not? I went across the threshold. In one case, I was pulled across. I didn't want to be. And I saw the Akashic record. I saw the skein of time, and I saw what was imprinted there and their intentions and their thoughts. But then I couldn't quite tell them in the real world, over here in the physical world, what was going on. And by the way, that amount of money meant nothing to this person. If she had found those boxes and got all the money back, it would have meant nothing to her. Okay. Nothing. Okay. So what are you doing that's good? What are you doing that's bad? If you want to start going across the threshold, and so many people want to see colors. Oh, I want to see colors. I want to see the astral body. I want to see the chakras. What John just held up was the chakras. That's exactly what the chakras look like. That's the ego view of all chakras. Matter of fact, they all merge into one that is very complicated, but let's just say there are multiple levels of the chakras, and they're different colors, and the petals, some come from the past, some from the present, some from the future. And as you develop them, if you are able to develop all of your chakras right now, all the petals and all of your chakras, let's just call them seven. There's actually many, many more. What would happen? You'd become an angel. Simple as that. Will we do that? No, not yet. So when we go across the threshold, the weaknesses that are written into the petals of our chakras turn into what the Tibetans call wrathful deities. And I'm smiling because you know, I never could understand, why did the Tibetans have so many wrathful monster beings who were supposed to be spiritual, who were, you know, throwing spiritual tools at you and blah, blah, and the fire and the demon and, da, 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 and there's demons all around. What is that all about? That's the path of initiation. And what is the Damascus event? It's the path of initiation. What is the second coming? It's your own personal apocalypse. Now, you can either experience this now through initiation and meditation and through spiritual development, or you can wait till you die, and then you're going to see that Christ is the Lord of karma, and that that scary being who held the fiery sword like the cherub at the gate of the Garden of Eden that pushes you back, that's Christ. Christ is the lesser guardian now, not the Sphinx, not St. Michael. And Christ is the greater guardian, not Anubis, not St. Peter, not any of those other versions. It's Christ. Christ is the Lord of karma. And every night he says to you, go back, resolve your evil, resolve your demon side. You know, I'll take care of you in the spiritual world at night. But guess what? You're not going to wake up in your dreams if you're carrying garbage, attempting to carry garbage across the threshold. If your soul is full of garbage, it's supposed to become the virgin soul. It's supposed to be the Holy Sophia, this being of wisdom. That's what your soul is. They're supposed to carry across the threshold. And when you do, exactly as John just said, and again, we didn't coordinate this talk, you carry your own light with you. And if you don't carry light, it's darkness. And if you are building a mansion over there, Christ calls it a mansion. We in the spiritual esoteric group call it your hut, because we know that we're just little babies. We're just building a little hut in the spiritual world that we're going to illuminate with our own light. That's our thinking, feeling, and willing. The blue room. We're creating the future. We're creating the temple of wisdom, right? But here's the deal. If people don't acknowledge Christ in the etheric or Christ in the physical, because Christ is living now. When people say they accepted Christ as their personal savior, look at them. They're not making it up. They had a personal, emotional, intuitive, spiritual experience. They might have even seen something. And when they did, they knew Christ was a living being. Same thing as Saul, who was turned into Paul on the road to Damascus at the Damascus event. Same thing happens for someone when they basically meet the lesser guardian. In other words, when you get saved, what do they say you're supposed to do? Same thing that happens tonight when you go to sleep. Get it, develop a clear conscience, go back, resolve all the bad stuff you did with people, take back the nasty words you've said, try to amend for what you've done, and clean up your life. And that is the lesser guardian. That's Christ. But if you want to meet Christ after you die, unfortunately, you better get this message that Rudolf Steiner and many other spiritual scientists say. You need to meet Christ now as a living being in the etheric world and in your etheric body. And if you do, then you won't go to crucify Christ after you die. That's what materialists do. They're crucifying Christ. That light body of the angel can't develop when your thoughts are gray shadow thoughts held in the spider web network of the digital world, which is really sub-nature coming right up out of the ground and taking over humans and sucking humans right down into hell. And that's what is happening day in, day out, as your free will is being taken away from you. So you can experience Christ as a living being now. And if you don't, you don't get a chance after you die. So when I follow people after they die, I listen to what Rudolf Steiner says. First 3 days, they go through a real quick flash memory of what they've done. And then they go through one third, let's say they live to be 90 years old, for 30 years, one third of the time that they were alive, they go through, and this is one of the craziest things, but I have to say the truth, they go through what they experienced at night, whether they remember their dreams or not, it doesn't matter. But really, literally, what you're dreaming at night, the digestion of what you did in the day, and the fact that Christ is the lesser guardian is saying, work it out on your own. You created these sins. You need to go back and resolve them, redeem your own self. Every night you're told that. But if you do that and you're on the path of initiation, you have moral development, a pure heart, as John has said, then you can go awake into sleep. And that's why last week I rattled off a whole lot of stuff. One of them was my whole young life, I was dreaming in the daytime world. And I was awake in the nighttime world. And we're going to talk about that soon. They call it astral travel.
That wonderful quote of Novalis, I didn't know you were going to bring that up, but he says to bring bring wakefulness into dream and dream into wakefulness. And nobody better than Novalis, that's for sure. But if you look into this, you'll see that a real key to understand, again, C.G. Harrison, Charles Harrison, in his Transcendental Universe, he says the three great axioms. One, 7 is the perfect number. 2, the microcosm is a copy of the macrocosm. And 3, all phenomena have their origin in vortices. That's like a vortex, right? These axioms are the foundation of occult science and are of the nature of universal truths, though not axiomatic or self-evident to the uninitiated, with the possible exception of number 2. Just as axiom 9 of Euclid, the whole is greater than its part, is a self-evident to the unreasoning dog in the case of a biscuit, as to the reasoning man. Okay, so I'm just giving you that because there are certain things that you can hold in your consciousness that can give you pieces that will help you solve this great, great riddle that's called you. And it goes back, there's a song by Steely Dan, Do It Again. In the morning you go gunning for the man who stole your water. And you fire till he's done, but they catch you at the border. And the mourners are all singing as they drag you by your feet. But the hangman isn't hanging, and they put you on the street. You go back, Jack, do it again, wheel turning round and round. You go back, Jack, do it again. And it goes on and on. So it just makes me think that guy knows something.
Reincarnation, yeah. Now, what you just described, I'm going to give the real short version of it. There's a vortex coming in from your head that comes from the sun and the planets. There's a vortex coming up from your feet and the earth, from the core of the earth, from all the stars. The entire circling realm of the stars comes up to your feet. These vortexes meet at your heart, and where they meet, they create the heart. And they move at different speeds. That's why your heart's an angle. I'm not going to go into that. Take that, turn it sideways, and you have two vortices. And the two vortices meet, and they make each of your chakras. So you have a vortex coming in from your back that's bringing in the energy, sucking in the energy. It meets at that nerve ganglia, the chakra, and then it comes out the front. So literally, a psychic looking at you sees cones of these spinning petals coming out of your chakras, okay? And they can literally put their hand in it and they can manipulate it. They can use their mind to change the colors. You can use your mind to change your colors. And going back to another previous point John made, if there's psychosomatic illness, then there's psychosomatic health. Now, Ariel was doing at the end, strangely enough, John's dear friend and my dear friend Ariel, she had gotten permission from the Pope to be the only woman doing the rite of exorcism as a woman in juvenile detention facilities out in Portland, Oregon. And this, she was dedicated to this.
But she was the only one doing the Eucharist too.
And she was allowed to do the Eucharist,
yeah,
which is extraordinary. So she was given extraordinary permission for this. In the end, I was working one of my last jobs within juvenile detention facilities with gentlemen, with juveniles who in many cases were possessed, obsessed. They were the kind of people who don't even, I've told you about people who are incarnated without a spirit and others who can't contact their soul. I met all those children. And all my life, my dad worked for the federal penitentiary system. So I worked in the penitentiary system with these people. And so I haven't met any weird person that you might consider to be weird that I didn't find empathy with, I guess you'd call it. And so I worked with these children, but I didn't use the rite of exorcism anymore because I'm not in the Catholic Church anymore. I would just work with them, and it was amazing. It was like Father William. He would get called to do the strangest things you could ever imagine in your whole life, and I would be right there with him. And no matter where we went, it didn't matter. He's in a wheelchair. He's a priest in his garb. They allowed us in. And so we got into some of the strangest circumstances you could ever imagine. And in these psych wards, you got to see people with the Messiah complex, the God complex, the Mary Magdalene complex, and they are basically mimicking something they witnessed that they were overwhelmed by and they got stuck on. And sometimes, literally, yes, you can just simply talk with them and they can come out of it. And so when I'm saying that in this day and age, the Damascus event is now available for everyone who wishes to see the second coming of Christ, I mean that quite literally.
Yes, and when you keep in mind, last week we talked about the path of the warrior, and that's what this is. I mean, when Douglas is going into penitentiaries and meeting with the shadows of criminals, that's an extraordinary event. But then if you look at it more closely, you see St. Paul was of the tribe of Benjamin, okay? The Benjaminites were renowned as warriors, okay? And the tribe of Benjamin, that many of them were destroyed through battle because of a certain event that happened with this member of their tribe and some other women. But I don't want to get it too distracted here. But in understanding that Benjamin is the tribe of Saul, okay? And he is like the original king. And so you have this whole idea that there's a lineage of being able to deal with the conflicted nature of human beings is what we're talking about here. So you have like the four gospels from the four, you know, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And then you have Paul, who's able to go in and confront people who are, I mean, if you met some of the people that he got to meet, I you would fall on your face. I mean, seriously, you walking into a camp of a bunch of warriors and you're going to go eyeball to eyeball with them? I don't think so. You know, so he was a formidable individual. And so we're talking about something that you have to meet it in your own terms gradually. Gradalis is the word in Latin. But what I would recommend, just to give people something that they can take with them, I have it here, the Effects of Esoteric Development by Rudolf Steiner. It's available. The lecture cycle is available on YouTube, and you can listen to the whole thing, and you can get into some of the themes that we're going to be addressing in the coming episodes. And I want to thank Tyla Gabriel for her ingenious way of putting things together to get us to talk about things that we wouldn't be talking about had she not asked us. So she's to be celebrated in that regard, and amongst other things. And I don't want to gush too much, but she's one of the most dynamic people that I have ever met. And likewise, she's brought it out of Douglas, because I don't think he'd be doing all the things that he does without her promptings. So Douglas, God bless you and thank you. And for everybody that showed up this week, I thank you very much, and we'll see you.
Dweller on the threshold, and I'm waiting at the door, and I'm standing in the darkness. I don't want